If you think you felt a great disturbance in the force, you're not wrong. Ed Gross and me, Mark A. Altman, have a new oral history coming out this July from St. Martin's Press. It's Secrets of the Force, the complete, uncensored, unauthorized oral history of the Star Wars saga. So wherever you buy books, audio, and video, pick it up today, pre-order, and you can learn the secrets of the Force. And don't miss our oral history of Star Trek in stores now. And of course, nobody does it better, the complete oral history of James Bond in digital, hardcover, paperback, and audio. That is all.
If you're a fan of the 430 movie, you'll love Best Movies Never Made, hosted by myself, Josh Miller.
And Steven Scarlatta.
Where we explore some of the greatest movies never made, like E.T. 2.
Johnny Quest.
Beetlejuice Goes Hawaiian.
And Halloween 3D.
New episodes available every other Monday, wherever you listen to podcasts.
If you're a fan of Inglourious Treksperts, you're going to love Treksperts Briefing Room, a
Treksperts
new series.
Briefing Room? What is that?
I was about to explain, then you interrupted me.
Sorry.
It's curated audio commentaries of classic Star Trek episodes from the original series all the way through Enterprise. You're going to love it as we explore the behind-the-scenes making of all these wonderful Star Trek episodes with cast and crew that you would never expect to hear doing audio commentaries on Star Trek.
Sounds like fun.
It will be. And you can find it on the Inglourious Treksperts podcast feed and on the new Treksperts Briefing podcast, wherever you listen to podcasts.
Let's go see
what's out there. This is Mark A. Altman, and this is Music to My Ears Week on the 430 Movie. And once again, I'm here with all your favorite 430 movie hosts.
Some of them.
I'm missing an action. So first we had the very melodic Monday, Mr. Stephen Melching.
Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. Mi, 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 mi.
It's always about you, 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 isn't it?
on Tuesday, we have the not very sibilant DAREN DOCHTERMAN.
You couldn't think of a musical
alliteration. I'm not very good Tuesday. I love music, but I'm
how
not
about,
good.
How about Tremolo Tuesday? How would that
be? Oh, there
be?
You go. How about treble? We're turning up the oh, no, wait. That's not.
No treble.
No treble.
All about that bass.
Okay. Okay. Very good. Very good. And then on Wednesday, what's a good musical term for Wednesday? Anyone?
Oh, boy.
No.
W. They're good W. What's a good W musical term?
You know, when the kids were young, I used to read them this book, M is for Music. And they had for every letter, they had a different musical word. I wish I had that book right now so I could come up with some good pun for Ashley Miller on Wednesday.
And
Life was an open book.
Open book.
Your heart was
I used to say
open.
Live and Let Live.
Yeah. You know you did.
You know you did. You know you did.
Oh, my gosh. And which version of that do you prefer? The Paul McCartney version or the one in the Filet of Soul restaurant? The cover version? The soul version?
I just watched that movie the other night because I'm going through all the Bond.
What we
order.
Have here is a man with a very small head who lost a fight with a chicken.
Yeah. It doesn't really hold up very well, does it?
No. Oh, come on. You know, it's a living life. This is what I will say about Live and Let Die. First of all, it has some great lines. Names are for tombstones, baby. But yeah, it's not very good. But you know, for me, what was cool growing up in New York was this was the James Bond movie that took place partially in New York. So I always thought that was cool. And you know, this whole chase on the FDR Drive. So whenever I went to my grandparents up the FDR Drive, I'm like looking around because I'm thinking there's a black pimp mobile following us.
I just noticed that there are so many 1972 Impalas in the movie.
Oh my God, totally.
Every shot, there is another. Apparently, they had a deal with Chevy.
Look, it's not a great movie, but it has Jane Seymour.
Hey, Yaphet Kotto
is great.
Everybody else in it is really weird, though.
It's for my money, it's one of the only Roger Moore James Bond movies where he's pointed a gun at somebody and I believed
that he was actually intending to shoot.
Come on.
You know what I mean?
How great. For your money, how much have you paid for it?
A lot.
How great is Jeffrey Holder? Jeffrey Holder is great as Baron Samedi.
No, he's not. He's mugging it, and it's hilarious. But you know, I prefer him in the 7-Up ads.
I was going to say,
I love the uncorder. I love the stuff in New Orleans. Whose funeral is this? Yours.
That's fine. It's kitschy though. It's kitschy.
Look, it's definitely kitschy. But you know, it proved to people that Roger Moore could be a great Bond, that the franchise could survive after Connery left and after Lazenby, and you know, Moore made that role his own for a long time.
Absolutely.
And you know, it also has the greatest one sheet. The one sheet is freaking gorgeous.
Yeah.
Plus, the George Martin. Not only that, the George Martin score is good. I love that scene where she's dealing the tarot cards. A man arrives over water, it shows the plane leaving, landing on Pan Am, landing in at JFK.
What's Pan Am? The kids ask.
That's right. I got to tell you, I saw Paul McCartney at the Hollywood Bowl a few years back, and he did "Live and Let Die," and it was freaking amazing. We had with the fireworks going off and all the big horn hits. It was tremendous.
You're saying that you really appreciate the music in "Live and Let Die"
more than the movie.
But here's the great story about that, and then we'll talk about music. The great story is I don't know if it was Saltzman or Broccoli, but when I listened to the demo tape of the song, you know, the Paul McCartney, he said, "This song is great. Who are we going to have record it?" And George Martin's like, "Well, Paul McCartney's going to record it in the studio." But who are we going to have record it? I mean, I know he wrote the song. It's like, no, you don't understand. You only get the song if Paul McCartney records it. He was a Beatle. And they're like, "Well, no, but we could get like Shirley Bassey or Frank Sinatra or somebody." And it's like, no.
Wow, that's bonkers.
It's amazing they made it out of the 70s.
Where would I read about this story, Mark?
Well, it's funny you say that. That's one of the many fascinating stories about the James Bond movies, as seen and heard in the oral history of the James Bond films and Spymania. Nobody Does It Better by Mark A. Altman and Ed Gross, available at bookstores now, as well as digital and audio. So pick it up today. Thanks, Steve. Well, you know, that was right down the middle. So anyway, music to my ears week. What does that mean? Well, I'll tell you, we're doing a week of movies with great motion picture scores that in many cases elevated the movies they were married to. Now, I want to ask you guys, because you know, a lot of times you see at the Oscars, it's the movies with the best songs that get nominated. Like, people can't tell the difference between a score and song, particularly with the Disney films. You know, they always win, and people are like, "I like those songs." But no, that's not
referring to the background score.
It's like, "Oh, that's Saturday Night Fever." You know, it's like, okay, David Shire did some nice instrumental music, but what people are talking about is they love the Bee Gees, right?
That's right. Congratulations to the music supervisor and the Bee Gees.
Yeah, exactly. That's not what we're honoring today. Although I do want to ask you guys, like, what are some movies that had great songs, like, you know, that you loved?
Well, certainly the movie that won the Oscar for the greatest movie ever made, Highlander. Flash Gordon.
It's Who Wants to Live Forever, actually.
Both of those, like, both of those movies had amazing soundtracks. The soundtrack, not the score, the soundtrack.
I'd make the same case with something like, Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid.
Yeah,
Bob Thriller. Sure. Mm-hmm. Did a great songs for it. Not Gonna Heaven's Door came out of that. But that's not what the show is about. That's not what we're reporter. We're here to talk about movie scores. I'd love to know from you guys, you know, when it was that you sort of discovered the music of the movies and got you excited about film music, because I know we're all big fans of film music here on the show. So Steve, like, when did you discover movie soundtracks?
Well, that's very easy. You know, that was the John Williams double LP soundtrack to Star Wars in 1977. That was, I think, the first LP I ever bought with my own money. Mm-hmm. And I became a huge, I always liked music before that. But that started me down the film score path. And I was buying film soundtracks and film scores in junior high and high school instead of rock and roll albums. I preferred the orchestral strains of Jerry Goldsmith and John Williams and the like. And I'm a huge film score fan.
What about you, Darren?
I think the realization that there was something called a film score that I could go and purchase came from Star Wars. But immediately after that, I sort of went back in my history of watching movies and found scores to all these other movies that I loved. And that is, it did sort of start the ball rolling on enjoying scores by themselves without the benefit of the visuals. I listened to like tons of score, like for the original 1938 Robin Hood, which I always loved watching it on TV. And what there was a re-recording of it made in the mid early 80s. And I just would listen to that thousands of times. But it is traceable back to 77 and that double LP. But man, it opened up an entire world of enjoyment.
What about you, Ashley? When did you sort of fall in love with movie music?
Yeah, well, I mean, obviously, the John Williams score for Star Wars is iconic. I would argue that The Empire Strikes Back is better, but that's neither here nor there because it's not about that. It's like, it's when did it kind of hit me? And I think I was mentally ready for it to hit me by the time that I saw Superman, the movie, in the theater. That was the first time I remember being consciously aware of feeling something and having that feeling being connected to the music on the screen and how the music on the screen married to what I was looking at, right? Like I was able to put that whole picture together. And weirdly, I think the moment that it landed for me, Superman landed, was when he and Lois are flying over Metropolis, right? Like there was just something about that moment that made me go, oh, click, holy crap, right? There's something that's happening with the music in this, and I'm feeling something because of it. And understand, it's like I'm, fucking 8-9 years old, and like I've never dated a girl. I couldn't tell her what color her panties are. Like none of those. but I felt something about that moment.
Yeah, yeah. It's really special part of the movies. And I'll tell you, it's interesting because I know we all had the Star Wars experience. I actually was purloining vinyl from my parents' record rack before Star Wars. I was stealing The Graduate. I was one of the albums I stole, but of course that was songs mostly. Simon Garfunkel,
but a great film soundtrack. Score.
Yeah, absolutely. But it was actually the Bond albums. I can tell you, they from Russia with Love, Goldfinger, and Thunderball. And boy, I played those all the time. They disappeared, never were returned. And The Great Escape. Albert Bernstein's magnificent score to The Great Escape. And I would listen to those all the time. So I was primed and ready for Star Wars. So when I saw Star Wars, I immediately wanted the album. And of course, they couldn't print them, much like the toys, quick enough. Right. So it was hard to get. And I remember my aunt called me and said, I got good news. I'm bringing the Star Wars. I found it for you. And she was always great bringing presents and toys. And she didn't have kids of her own. So she would always bring us great stuff. And so she shows up that one night for dinner and she had the Miko album. And I'm like, oh, come on. And it's like, I was so disappointed. And so.
Not that the Miko album isn't great.
No, and I listened to it a lot. But yeah. What was it? What was it called again? Music from the Galaxy? No, music from.
No, it's just music. Star Wars. Star Wars and other galactic
Star Wars and other funk. Another galactic funk. Right. Okay. And then, there were so many knockoffs at the time. It was amazing. It was, so many different albums. But I finally got the Star Wars. And that's where, of course, I learned the word Dianaga, because that was the first time I ever saw it published in the trash compactor. And it's funny because I actually got the score for Empire Strikes Back before I saw the movie. Yeah, so I remember listening to that. And the first thing that comes on side one is the Imperial March, right? Or is it something inside two? And I must have played that 1,000 times.
Yeah.
I must have needed a new needle on my record player because
I ruined a needle on that album. Yeah.
My best friend had bought that album, and I just remember going to his house and, you know, laying down on the floor in front of the stereo with hushed breath, just listening to the album straight through and wondering, wow, this is amazing. This is so cool.
But that was a piece. Sorry, go ahead, Steve.
No, you can keep talking about Empire. I was going to change the subject.
Well, no, I was just going to say, but there was a piece of vinyl that was 1980, but there was a piece of vinyl we all owned the year before that was perhaps just as seminal for many of us. And of course, that was Jerry Goldsmith's magnificent score for Star Trek, the Motion Picture.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I still have my copy. It is ruined.
Destroyed.
It has, you know, but luckily it's been
preserved in perfect preserved detail. And
transformed into data patterns. so that we can all enjoy it now perfectly.
Equally.
Stored here with every detail.
It's funny, Mark, you mentioned raiding your parents' record cabinet, and I did the same thing. And I remember one LP that I found in there that I still, it just boggles my mind that they owned this album.
Yeah,
I kind of, it was A Clockwork Orange.
Oh my God.
They had the LP, the early LP soundtrack to Clockwork Orange, and I had never seen the movie. I'd barely heard of it, but I remember playing it and being fascinated by this record, and it was years until I finally saw the movie.
Dug Ludwig van?
Yeah, well, man.
Wendy Carlos.
All time steps.
Yeah.
It was a cool album.
I Want to Marry a Lighthouse Keeper.
Yeah, keep him company.
That was just a comment. That wasn't about the album.
So listening to Star Wars, and that got me kind of into classical music, which led me down a path of being a musician in my early years. I was wondering, I know Darren was a musician in school, and yeah. I was as well. Do you want to talk about that, Darren?
You just said something that triggered my memory. Star Wars wasn't the first soundtrack album I went nuts over. Fantasia was.
Oh, interesting.
I listened to that in kindergarten. Over and over again. And I think at some point I made the mistake of standing up in kindergarten and conducting a piece from that.
Leopold?
Well, here's a question about Fantasia. All right. This is where we need a ruling from the line judge on Fantasia. Yeah. Now, the music for Fantasia was not obviously. Like none of those songs
were for the film,
specifically right. for that animation.
It's like a
the
song animation score,
was, right? It's actually like it's a soundtrack. It's not a score. It's a soundtrack.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's both because it was recorded specifically for the movie.
Yes, but the music was not written for the movie, which is I think the difference.
Yeah, but you can argue that a lot of James Horner's compositions weren't written specifically for the movie.
That's true. It's like Aliens is basically like Star Trek 2 and Battle Beyond the Stars.
And Humanoids from the Deep. And,
yes. Yeah.
So, yeah. You know, let's not go there. But I think that if whatever the music, I think we're talking about if it's orchestral, it's non-sung, and it's not broken up into, you know, like 4-minute bites. I think that can determine whether or not it's a score.
But what about RoboCop 2? It's sung RoboCop, RoboCop. And then, of course, let's not forget Ennio Morricone's brilliant score for Red Sonja. Sonja.
Oh, my God.
Sonja.
Yeah, does that soundtrack? But that's score. It's like, I don't know. It's weird. It's weird what the distinction is. But to me, it's that's another question, okay? Because now we're into songs that were written specifically for movies.
Yeah.
So Rocky IV, John Barr, right? Uh-huh. Like, okay, so he's writing songs for that movie. That's not that soundtrack, not score.
That soundtrack, absolutely.
Yeah.
But
interesting, isn't it?
Under 4 minutes.
But St. Elmo's Fire isn't.
Right? Except soundtrack. That.
Yeah.
Okay. So look, we decided to do, you know, a few weeks ago, we honored cinematography with our Pictures Worth a Thousand Words. We, you know, a lot of the unsung heroes of motion pictures, to us, you know, film composers don't get the love and respect that they deserve. You know, again, you ask people what their favorite movie scores are, and it's always Grease. I love Grease. First of all, not only does that not count, but it was also based on a Broadway play first. So it's wrong in so many ways. Not that the songs aren't great. They are. But, you know, that's not a great movie score. Okay.
By the way, next week is Best Boy Week on the 4:30.
Monday, it's a spinner. Okay. So I wanna before we start talking about these, the day we're recording this show, the great Norman Lloyd passed away at 106 years old. And I'd be remiss if we didn't pay our respects to this amazing, amazing man. You know, look, a lot of the audience, you know, maybe from St. Elsewhere, you probably know him from his one episode of Star Trek, The Next Generation. But the fact is, this man belongs on the Mount Rushmore of movies. Yeah. He worked with Orson Welles, John Houseman. He was in Saboteur, working with Hitchcock for many years. Just a remarkable raconteur first class. I saw him, Steve, I think you did as well, at the Telluride Film Festival, where he regaled us for hours with stories of his career. And
sharp as a tack in his 80s. Telling all these great stories.
His loss means a horrible hole in live 6 degrees of separation.
I mean, this man was born right after World War I broke out.
Yeah.
He was here for the entirety of the American film industry, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah, and he worked on many seminal films, and the ones he didn't, he knew. He was friends with Chaplin, with Buster Keaton.
Yeah.
I mean, extraordinary.
He knew people.
He knew a guy. And you know, apparently he was playing tennis till he was 103.
That's a
problem there.
Right.
We always talk about how we should be lucky enough at 90 to be like Shatner, but I think, you know, we'd be lucky enough at 100 to be like Norman Lloyd. So
be lucky enough at 70 to be like Norman.
Just an extraordinary guy. And if you don't know much about Norman Lloyd, you should really check out his films and do a little research on him, because he was a really extraordinary guy. And I'm just really lucky. We were lucky to sort of bathe in the glow of his appearance. Like I said, I just knew him from St. Elsewhere. And I didn't really know the history, and listening to him speak was really one of the great joys of, my many movie-going experiences. And Steve, we were really lucky. And then he went back to Telluride like 10 or 15 years later, and apparently was just as charming and just as endearing. And, you know, I always loved his character in St. Elsewhere, and I even loved his character on Next Generation. You know, he played Picard's mentor in The Chase. So, okay.
Yes.
Rest in peace, Norman Lloyd. Today's episode, music to my ears. And as always, we curate a fantasy theme week of classic movies, starting with Monday and Steve Melching. Steve Melching, what's your pick for Monday?
Wow. Well, this is a huge topic. And I chose to narrow it down along the lines of something we discussed, of the score being a great score that, as you said earlier, elevated the movie that it's in, or took a movie that might have been, you know, a C movie and turned it into a B or B plus or a B, you know, like that brought the movie up a level just through its sheer creativity and power, and really, you know, brought out depths and subtleties that may or may not have been in the film itself, and just really, really made the movie something that it might not have, that it wouldn't have been otherwise without this particular score. And I was stuck between two movies for the longest time. And the other movie, I'm sure, is a strong contender for Friday. And it's a strong contender for probably many other weeks on the show, because it's a classic. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go for a movie that is not considered a classic. But the score to this movie just knocked my socks off from the very beginning, seeing this movie in the theater. And this is a movie from, and it's been the music, the score for this has been part of my writing playlists for years since then. It's great writing music. And I just love it. And it is the score and the film for 2010's Tron Legacy by Daft Punk.
What do you say? Tomorrow, you and I hit the arcade. First game's on me.
Can we play doubles? On the same team?
We're always on the same team.
Good evening.
Our lead story, Kevin Flynn, was reported missing. The visionary icon and NCOM CEO skyrocketed to the top of the tech industry. He was last seen at home with his son, Sam, leaving behind an empire and a now orphan little boy.
Sam, I was paged last night. Paige came from your dad's office at the arcade.
Alan, you're acting like I'm gonna find him sitting there working.
Where am I?
Your father was the creator. He never thought he'd see you again.
Dad. Sam. Long time.
You have no idea.
The grid. A place of infinite possibility.
It's incredible.
More beautiful than I ever dreamed. And more dangerous than I ever imagined.
What happened?
My creation turned against me.
Kevin Flynn! Where are you now?
What am I supposed to do?
Survive.
We have to get you out of here.
Up there! There's a new world!
Here they come!
Up there! Is our destiny.
And the film itself, I think, is okay. You know, Tron, the original Tron, I have a lot of affection for. It's a cool movie. It's fun. It has its own groundbreaking score by Wendy Carlos, and you know, electronic orchestral hybrid. And the sequel actually, I think, did a lot of really interesting things with a movie that was kind of goofy originally. But the new movie, the story is decent. It gets a little weird by the third act for me, but I love the first half of it, and it's got a great. I like the cast, Jeff Bridges and Olivia Wilde and Garrett Hedlund and Bruce Boxleitner and Michael Sheen, directed by Joseph Kosinski, with great visual flair. And I know Darren helped out on that on the design team.
Extremely little.
It is a gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous looking movie. It's immaculate. The design of the grid space is tremendous. But on top of that, you have this astounding score by Daft Punk, which just blasts over the speakers. You know, Daft Punk, those guys, these two French guys, Guy Manuel de Homem Christo and Thomas Bangalter. I'm sure I butchered those names, but I've never.
That's why they call themselves Daft Punk.
Yeah,
right, so you can pronounce it.
And they're primarily electronic artists and DJs and doing house music and stuff. They've had they've won 6 Grammys. They've put out several albums. But they were fans of the original Tron, and apparently it took a while for Joseph Kosinski to get through to them because they were touring, and they were a little reluctant to take on the project at first because they actually really did like the original film and wanted to make sure that the sequel would live up to it. And once they got involved, you know, I think they took the ball. They took the disc and ran with it and created this score that is just enveloping and powerful and a real, a true fitting successor to the Wendy Carlos score from the original movie. And it, once again, it's a combination of electronic music and an 85-piece orchestra recorded in London and arranged and orchestrated by Joseph Trapanese. And the film, the soundtrack, the score album charted at number 10 on the Billboard chart, which is a rarity for a film score. Star Wars famously did that back in 1977. And it's a certified gold record. And so, to me, it took a sequel that might have just been, you know, maybe a C+ or B-, and just brought it up a full letter grade for me.
Yeah, man, I could talk about the score kind of forever. I mean, I'm with you. Like, there's a lot about Tron Legacy that kind of leaves me going, I mean, the movie ends, like, and she's supposed to be impressed that they're riding a motorcycle into fucking Vancouver. Like, okay, I guess that's happening. But as a score, right, from beginning to end, like, it's whatever my other problems are with that film, it is an incredibly well-conceived and well-directed score because it does, it turns it into kind of an electronic opera, and it really helps tell the story. There's a reason why if you buy the disc, you can, and I don't know if there's anything else out there that's like this. You can turn off all the dialogue and just watch the movie with the score, which is frankly my preferred viewing experience, which is like, and I don't want to like to crap on the movie itself, because I actually think there's like some cool stuff in there. But I think that the combination of the visuals and the music is so specific and so cool. And that the score itself, it isn't just scoring the different sequences, and it isn't kind of creating a wallpaper that goes in the background. It's truly scoring the film. It's telling an entire story from beginning to end musically, and it's fascinating. And it owes a lot to a lot of things that have come before it, but it really takes it and it elevates it, and it makes it feel new, which I think is really the trick. And it's just incredibly well done. And I'm with you. Like, I can listen to this while I write or while I do anything, like, over and over and over again. And I love watching Tron Legacy with just the score. It's just, it's kind of an amazing audiovisual experience.
I enjoy the score to Tron Legacy way more than the film.
Yes.
and I think that it's fascinating that its textures and its melodies and the structure of the score stand on their own extremely well. And sometimes it works so much better than the film that it's jarring when you're watching the film, because the music is taking you in one direction and the movie is going into a horrible little jaunt into a frightening uncanny valley. And it's a very odd thing. I mean, I have a lot of negative feelings built in for the film for reasons I won't go into, but I do enjoy the score extremely much. And it's a fun listen.
Well, it's so relentless. It just powers you through. I mean, it just picks you up.
It's a big electronic train that carries you through the
through movie. It's just propulsive and relentless and creative.
I want to correct Ashley that actually isolated audio scores are fairly common on a lot of Blu-rays and DVDs. So it's not unique to Tron Legacy. But also, I got to say, I too really love the score. I don't particularly like the movie. I think the score is terrific. I remember, you know, our good friends, Rob Burnett and his former wife, Yelena, used to have these great Friday night parties at their house where they would put on usually Barbarella, and they would just have, you know, with the sound off and just play either Air or Daft Punk and a bunch of techno. And it was always delightful. So bad movies can always benefit from great scores. And that was always fun. But I actually thought, Steve, it's funny. you went with Daft Punk, you know, which is obviously a big, you know, techno, you know, DJs and everything. I thought you were going to go.
That's not normally my scene at all.
Yeah,
that's
right, really my thing. I'm surprised because I would have pegged you as Wang Chung to Live and Die in L.A. So I'm a little surprised by.
Eve is no Rob Burnett.
I like electronic music. I like Vangelis Tangerine Dream and stuff like Kraftwerk. But house music, this kind of house stuff isn't really my thing, but God, I love this score.
No, great score. And don't say Tangerine Dream because we haven't gotten to Wednesday yet.
Yeah.
So, that brings us to Darren and Tuesday. The first pick, Steve, Tron Legacy is on the board for Monday. What's it going to be for Tuesday?
Well, Steve brought us into the recent path. I'm going to take us even farther back to 1970, a movie that was actually a TV movie that was directed by Delbert Mann, starring George C. Scott and Susanna York. It is yet another version of Jane Eyre.
What did you learn at Lowood? Music? To play?
A little, sir.
Of course. They all play a little. Go to the piano. Play something.
I was not wrong then in my assessment.
You're very cool. An orphan child of low degree. Where do you find such coolness?
Out of my head, sir.
The one I see on your shoulders?
Yes, sir.
And has it other furniture of the same kind within?
It is well stocked, I hope, sir.
I've talked about the Orson Welles version of this a couple years ago. But this version is very interesting. It is, in fact, on Amazon Prime, and you can watch it. It is there. And it's fascinating. Of course, Rochester is played by George C. Scott, not the one from the Jack Benny Show.
Oh, Rochester!
I knew that was coming. But the score is done by a fairly young and relatively inexperienced John Williams.
Johnny Williams.
He is gorgeous. No, this is at the point where he stopped being Johnny Williams. And it is absolutely astonishing. The depth that this score has and the complexity, it sounds exactly like, like a William Walton or, you know, early English classical music.
Thank you.
amazing the ability he can be chameleon-like and transform his style into the style of the time that the movie takes place. It's truly lovely. All the cues on it are brilliant. There's a re-recording of it that is out there that I was first introduced to it from. It is absolutely lovely. And if you can watch it on Amazon Prime, it's great. The movie itself is fine. It's not great. It's lit very well. George C. Scott is interesting in anything he's in. Mm. But it's a little stilted. It's a little... It's a little odd. You know, it's 1970. The movie industry had been going into a horrible spiral to almost death. So,
by the way, how great are those George C. Scott stories in the Mike Nichols biography?
Oh, they're great. They're amazing. Oh,
so great.
They're amazing. I won't go into my George C. Scott story again, but it's... the movie is fascinating to watch. Susanna York is luminous. 8 years before she plays Superman's mother. Yes. Check it out, because the score is absolutely amazing. And the score did win. Let me check on here. It did win an Emmy, primetime Emmy, at the Emmy Awards from 1972, so it probably came out late 1970, or maybe it even aired in 1971. But John Williams won Outstanding Achievement in Music Composition for a special program, and George C. Scott won Outstanding Single Performance by an Actor at the Primetime Emmys in 72.
Well, my question to Steve and Ashley is, are we going to allow this pick? This is the first time a MOW TV movie has been picked on the show. And there has been some question as to whether those should count. So
who questions
are we going to allow Darren to pick this, or are we going to make him pick something else?
You know, if it were you, Mark, I would say no. But I don't want Darren to cry because I can't handle it. I just can't.
I certainly can't.
I think we've had TV stuff on before. I'm fine.
No, we haven't.
Was it
okay.
Ever exhibited theatrically?
I'm sure it was anyway, at some point.
Anywhere.
Internationally, probably.
Internationally.
But, I mean, Delbert Mann, you know. I mean,
John Williams.
The pedigree of this is all movies, baby.
Well, look, you know what? Steve and Ashley have said allow it. So regardless of my vote, I assume you would say to allow it.
One again.
It's allowed. It's allowed. The motion is denied.
The particular nature of this week, I think it's easier to allow it.
Steve has done some research, apparently.
Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention with Tron Legacy.
We're back to Monday. We're going back in time.
Darren mentioned awards, and that soundtrack was not even nominated for an Oscar, despite it probably maybe should have winning, although the score that won that year was The Social Network by Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross, which I think is a brilliant score. So maybe I would still give that one the edge, but you know, it lost to, you know, How to Train Your Dragon and the King's Speech.
Alexander, I remember the Tron Legacy score. I don't really remember the Social Network score.
Social Network is a great score. Social Network,
no, it is. I do remember it being great, but I can't go, oh yeah, I remember that, you know, D-Rest. You know what I'm saying? Like I don't sort of mentally call it up.
I don't recall the edge working on that score. You said you were going to give it the edge, and I don't think that.
I didn't know. I said I was going to edge it a little bit.
Ashley, you're going to have your chance in a second, because we've come to Wednesday.
Speaking of edging, we've come to Wednesday.
And now we get to hear your pick for Music to My Ears Week. We've had Daft Punk and Tron Legacy. We've had John Williams and Jane Eyre. And now we come to Wednesday.
Yeah, man. Look, this is a tough week for me because I love film score. I love what score can do for a movie. I love, or for a television show, quite frankly. how, you know, that soundscape can really define the emotional experience of the film. Again, it's like I referenced Superman, the movie. It was that being that part of that experience for me was how I felt about that movie came down to the score. And very often how I experience the music will inform how I experience the film. And something that had a huge impact on me and has seen something of a revival, I think in part because, you know, nostalgia is cool. I think in part because, you know, Tron Legacy like had a huge impact on how film is scored. Is that kind of that electronica, right? Like if I were to kind of point to something very recent that I thought was an incredibly successful example of that sort of a score, I would point to Thor Ragnarok, which I thought had just an amazing, amazing score. And what I thought was really terrific about it was just that combination of taking an instrumental orchestral score and really and taking the synth and using the synth, you know, kind of in the high notes, right? In that high range and kind of in the low range and just and really buttressing it and giving it texture with the synths. And then turning it around. I mean, there's so many things that score does that are just amazing. But I don't know that you can have a conversation about Thor Ragnarok or you can have a conversation about even Tron Legacy unless you really talk about how electronica in the context of an orchestral score in film really began, which takes me back to Tangerine Dream. Now, Tangerine Dream has got a lot of great scores, and I'm not going to name names because I feel like that's partly a conversation for Friday. And I really debated what was the movie I was going to bring up as my example of what it is that you need to watch and you really need to listen to get it. There's some terrific examples, some of which are quite unexpected. And again, I'll talk about that on Friday. But I think you have to go back to May of 1977. Movie comes out directed by one of the most successful box office, in terms of box office and critical, successful directors working in Hollywood with the star of really the first blockbuster in Hollywood history. A movie that people expected was going to do extraordinarily well and then came out and got kind of a middling critical response at the time and then got swamped. Because, kids, it's May of 1977 when Star Wars comes out. And Star Wars consumes all the oxygen in the room, and rightfully so. But a movie comes out by William Friedkin. I mean, we just made a mention of To Live and Die in L.A. and Wang Chung and all that other stuff. And Friedkin is one of the great thriller directors of all time. He had directed, of course, The Exorcist, which has also an amazing score. But he comes out with this movie called Sorcerer.
In 1971, William Friedkin directed The French Connection. It received 5 Academy Awards, including Best Picture of the Year. In 1974, he directed The Exorcist. It made history. Since then, Friedkin has spent over 2 years in 5 countries on 3 continents creating his latest film. An unusual adventure into the realm of suspense. By their past, robbed of their future, trapped in a life that was also a death. 4 men take an incredible chance, face an impossible challenge, and risk the only thing they have left to lose. Roy Scheider, in a new film by William Friedkin. Sorcerer, rated PG, parental guidance suggested.
Now, we generally say that Sorcerer is a remake of The Wages of Fear, right? The plot is that Roy Scheider and some French dude find themselves in the Dominican Republic for various reasons. They're stuck there. They need money. They want to get out. and something happens. An oil rig explodes and it's on fire. And the owner of the rig needs to put it out. To put it out, he needs to get dynamite to the site. But the dynamite that he's got has been stored improperly. So nitroglycerin is leaking everywhere, which means that transporting it is incredibly difficult, incredibly dangerous. They hire 4 drivers to drive this stuff 200 miles from point A to point B. Roy Scheider and this French guy are 2 of the drivers who have to make this perilous journey, which is really only about half the film. The tension in the film is fantastic, as you might imagine. Again, we're talking about William Friedkin. It looks beautiful. Again, we're talking about William Friedkin. The acting is terrific. But what's going on musically is the debut of Tangerine Dream in a film score, kind of bringing, you know, their electronica vibe to this film. And there are tracks in that movie that you listen to that you're like, oh, I recognize that. I don't even know that it's from this movie, from 1977 Sorcerer, but I do recognize that music. And I recognize how that music and how that approach to music evolved over time, and how even now we look back at it, whether we're talking about Tron Legacy or Thor Ragnarok or Stranger Things, right? You can't have conversations about that. You can't talk about John Carpenter. You can't talk about Alan Hovarth. You can't talk about like any of those guys unless you're talking about what Tangerine Dream did in 1977 in Sorcerer. And it's truly awesome. Look, the movie on its own is great. It's gone through something of a critical renaissance. Like they re-released it like in HD 4K, like I think like a couple years ago. It looks beautiful. It is absolutely worth your time to watch it. It's Roy Scheider, star of Jaws, who's awesome. It's great on all those levels. But as a debut, as a coming out party for Tangerine Dream, it's amazing. Should be noted, William Friedkin, who specifically went after Tangerine Dream to do the score after seeing them in concert, said after they had scored Sorcerer, said he had wished they had scored The Exorcist. Okay? The Exorcist, which has some of the most iconic music. Like, you think about Tubular Bells, right? Like, you hear that, you know, the Tubular Bells song, you think of The Exorcist. And William Friedkin is like, you know what? Screw it. I wish I'd had Tangerine Dream. That's how great a job they did. For new kids to the party, that's how interesting this score is. And frankly, it changed film scores. I mean, look, in some ways for the better, in some ways, like trying to ape that, I think, kind of led people to doing score on the cheap, which isn't good. But overall, like as an exercise in how music gets married to film, I think Sorcerer is just exceptional.
Agreed. Yeah, well, look, I wouldn't argue with that. I'm really glad you didn't say Legend, because then I would have had to say Jerry Goldsmith for Legend. We would have really had to duke it out. But Tangerine Dream's great. I love their score for Near Dark. Obviously, I love their score for Risky Business in particular. Mm-hmm. I love their score for Legend, and I love Jerry's score for Legend. Yeah. So, and it's funny that you mentioned Thor Ragnarok, because of course that's a great score, but I can't divest that from the brilliant use of Led Zeppelin's Immigrant Song, which is right. The best use of Led Zeppelin since Song Remains the Same. So, but it's a great pick. I mean, Sorcerer is a great movie. You're absolutely right. It's gone through a critical renaissance. It's a shame because, you know, thank God for home video, because this is a movie that totally, like you said, you know, the air was sucked out because of Star Wars, and it sort of was considered like the beginning of the end of William Friedkin's career, which was so unfair because it's really a masterpiece.
But you know what? The special edition version of Sorcerer with the extra visual effects is terrible.
Well, yeah, especially like with all the little creatures running around in the background. That's so weird.
The CGI dynamite talking to them.
Totally. And I liked it better when Jabba the Hutt wasn't like a big creature. That was weird.
You know, it's funny. My old bank branch that I used to bank at, behind the teller window, there was a massive mural that was like 40 feet long of Hollywood Boulevard. And with the Chinese theater in the middle of it. And the marquee was Sorcerer. And it's so funny, like they chose that moment in time to memorialize on this gigantic mural. And they could have just made it a week later when Star Wars moved into the theater.
But it's so funny, Steve. For those of you at home watching on the Electric Now channel, Steve gave the game away. He's wearing a 4:30 movie t-shirt with the Tron typeface. So he was telegraphing his
typeface.
That's actually a good idea.
It is kind of, because it's like I think it's actually like the typeface for the film was based on how they painted the name on the truck, which is why it's called Sorcerer.
Right,
it's named after the truck.
Thanks for giving things away.
Yeah, if you haven't checked out some of this great 4:30 movie swag, go to 4:30movie.com. 4:30moviepod or 4:30movie.com.
4:30movie.com.
4:30movie.com. There's some really great merchandise for the show.
Fun things for the kids.
Fun things. Yeah, absolutely. Kids. Check it out. You know, for kids.
And you could get your Pete Potwistle gear.
That's right.
Which, God knows, that one's never going to go away.
I think that one's on the ingloriustrexperts.com store. I don't know. Maybe I'll add them to both.
Yeah, great. Tangerine Dream.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, one of my favorite cues there is making love on a real train from Risky 100%. Business.
That's right. Yeah.
It's very difficult to make the choice, P.S.
Near Dark was the first CD I bought along with Peter Gabriel's So and Pete Townsend's White City. Those inaugurated my CD player back in 19.
Wow, and that Near Dark has been out of print forever.
Forever.
I tried to find it a few years ago and I could not.
Well, Steve, I'm sure we can work something out.
Okay. I did get it.
Okay. Ultimately. Okay. There you go. So, okay. That brings us to Thursday.
That's you, Mark.
It is. And boy, you've made this difficult because, you know, of course, I now have heard your picks and, you know, there's certain things that I need to reflect in my thinking. One of the first things I knew was that I was not going to repeat any of the picks on the show. So great, great scores like John Barry's Body Heat and David Shire's Taking a Pelham 1-2-3 and Albert Bernstein's Great Escape and Albert Bernstein's Sweet Smell Success. And obviously Jerry Goldsmith's Star Trek The Motion Picture and John Barry's On the Majesty's Secret Service. I'm eliminating all those. It has to be something that hasn't been on the show before. You know, hearing, you know, the composers you've picked, you know, sort of helped me narrow it down. I'm not going to go with like a Bruce Broughton for Silverado or Young Sherlock Holmes because certainly one of the greatest composers of all time, one of the greatest film composers, probably the greatest film composer, certainly along with John Williams, is the great Jerry Goldsmith. And none of his scores have been represented yet. I'm a huge Jerry Goldsmith fan, you know, and so I feel any week devoted to film music, Jerry needs to be represented. Of course, Patton has been on the show before. I'm not going to pick Patton. But that leaves so many shows, so many things. And I got to say, is it Chinatown? No, I'm going to save this. Is it LA Confidential? Is it Basic Instinct? Is it The Swarm? I can't pick The Swarm.
I would be so impressed.
Now, The Swarm is for you, Lieutenant D'Amato. I'm gonna pick a film, which is not a masterpiece by any means. It's quite a good film. It's having rewatched it recently, I have a newfound appreciation for it. And the music, I used to listen to music all the time, and in fact, it's on my writing playlist. I've listened to score a lot more than I've seen the movie, And but having recently rewatched the movie, I realized how good the movie is. And that film, my pick for Thursday, is Jerry Goldsmith's score for Capricorn One.
We are T-minus 18 seconds from liftoff. We're T-minus 15 seconds.
Would you and your men please follow me?
Jerry, what the hell is this?
This is an emergency. Please follow me, now!
T-minus 10 seconds, 9, 8, we have ignition, 6, 5, we have outboard engines, 3, we have inboard engines, 1, 0, we have a launch commit, we have a liftoff at 35 minutes after the hour.
Every split second of this historic flight, every intimate detail, every heartbeat was monitored by Mission Control in Houston.
This is Capricorn One. We have landed.
As millions all over the world watched and listened, the President of the United States spoke to the astronauts across the vastness of space.
To the men of Capricorn One, I bring you greetings from your fellow Americans.
There's only one small catch. It never happened. It's all a lie. A fantastic $30 billion hoax.
Something's wrong, and I don't know what it is.
Dig deep enough, you might uncover the truth.
Those signals couldn't have come from 300 miles.
But the odds are, you'll never live to tell it.
Freeze!
I'm not moving an inch.
We're on the plane together! There's a device, it's on the plane. There's some people, if I don't give them the all clear signal, they'll explode it.
Something's wrong, something big. They know I'm onto it and they try to kill me.
Who's they?
I can't tell you.
We are dead.
You tell me you're in trouble, you're out on bail, you just got fired, I tell you I'll be right over.
My head hurts.
You look awful.
Thank you very much.
You're quite welcome.
These people are capable of anything.
You sound so close. It's hard to believe you really are that far away in space.
It's hard for me to believe it, too.
You're up to something. You want my help.
It's gotten out of control. It's too big.
Capricorn 1, this is Houston. Capricorn 1, we show red on the heat shield. Capricorn 1, this is Houston. We show red on the heat shield. Do you read?
Pull that lever down by your feet when I tell you, sonny.
Capricorn 1, the mission that never got off the ground.
Oh.
Yeah, and it's a great score, which improbably was married for many years to Outland, which was always really weird that the CD had was married at Capricorn 1 and Outland. Then later on, they got their own separate CDs.
The Hyams connection.
Yeah, but they don't really, you know, Outland kind of, if anything, belongs with Alien, which was also picked previous weeks, which tried to pick Alien. But Capricorn 1 is a terrific nail-biting thriller in which the mission to Mars goes horribly awry. It was made in the late 70s. Conspiracy post-Watergate was at its height. And Hal Holbrook is behind in the nefarious plotting to fake the Mars landing.
Yep.
And it has this great cast. It has the great Elliot Gould as a reporter. James Brolin, never been better. As the captain of the mission, Sam Waterston is his second in command, and then there's
O.J. Simpson,
and you know, look.
Well, if you have Tangerine Dream in one thing, you have O.J. in another.
It's O.J. Simpson, and you know, it was interesting when we were watching it, trying to explain who he was to the kids. So, Capricorn One is terrific, and Hal Holbrook is just sensational.
Amazing.
In it.
Just for that one scene, he steals the movie.
He's so good, and there's some great performances across the board. You know, it's Peter Hyams. You know, Peter Hyams had did some really strong work early in his career. I never better, I think, than Capricorn One.
You know, later on when you get to the '80s and Star Chamber in 2010 and some of the other movies, you know, Burn on Wire was John Badham, but Capricorn One is just a terrific movie, as is Outland, which has been on the show before. So my pick for Thursday is the great, Capricorn One, scored by, the brilliant, curmudgeon, super talented Jerry Goldsmith.
It's an absolutely phenomenal score, and on YouTube there is a video of all the B-roll of the behind the scenes shooting of Capricorn One, and it's basically silent, and there's no editing in it. It's just footage of them shooting in the desert
that.
And at the gas station. It's really amazing and fun. And you can see the second ADs on their walkie-talkies trying to talk to the helicopter pilots, trying to coordinate with them to get them to line up correctly. It's really fascinating. But Capricorn One is one of my... It's a great scene. And the helicopters
when they come out of the sun,
are characters.
Iconic.
With the help of Jerry Goldsmith's amazing score. And he has a couple... late motifs in there that are just, you know, once you hear them, you know exactly what's going on. You know, boom, 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 boom. Just in the background, you know something bad's about to happen.
And I used that to score a bunch of my Super 8 movies in high school and college. So, I mean, you know, I used a lot of Jerry Goldsmith and probably more Capricorn One than virtually anything else. You know, look, the only other movie that I really would have picked would have been John Williams' 1941. Because again, that's a score that elevates a mediocre movie and makes it that much better. It's one of the, you know, in any other composer, it would have been their greatest score. But it's John Williams, so it's not his greatest score. But it's pretty spectacular. It's pretty spectacular. So, okay. So that brings us to Friday. And I mean, there's so many choices. You know, we picked Conan the Barbarian before Basil Poledouris.
I have a crazy suggestion for Friday.
Go ahead.
Hear me out on this one. Because one of the, you know, we've basically talked about kind of two genres, right? Like we've, on this episode in particular, we've talked about, you know, the electronica kind of married with the orchestral. We've talked about Jerry Goldsmith quite a lot. And what I think would be a fascinating pick for Friday would be to pick Legend. And here's why. Because as we all know, there are two scores to that movie. There's the Jerry Goldsmith score. There's the Tangerine Dream score. You can see the movie with both scores, right? And as an exercise, just in watching film and how score can change the way we experience film, I think Legend is a really good pick because it's difficult to see a film. I mean, I'm sure there are other examples and you guys are probably about to like hit me with like, well, here's five or six. But as a way of looking at how to approach Friday, I think that's pretty cool because you can just find Legend and say, well, what does that sound like with Tangerine Dream? What does that sound like with Jerry Goldsmith? I happen to love both scores. They're very different, but I happen to love both.
I would go even farther back.
Okay.
To 1927.
Oh my God. That was before music was invented.
Yeah. Well, no, actually, because, the original score to Metropolis by Gottfried Huppertz which was just released a few years ago by Kino Lorber, is amazing. They did a re-recording of the original score for the silent movie, and it is lush and evocative, and truly adds to the impact of the film, which is already impactful with no score. Back in 1984, Giorgio Moroder did an electronic soundtrack for it that is, it's fine. It's not my favorite, but the original score is amazing.
But you know what, though? The fact that you mentioned that, because I agree, and it's interesting, right? Just to be able to listen to how different composers approach the same material, because I agree with you, by the way, about Metropolis. I think you're 100% right. I think that's a great pick.
I think you guys are on to something. I'm intrigued by the legend thing, but I would also think, it'd be really sad if, say, James Horner wasn't represented. I can think of so many scores, from Alien to Gorky Park to Wrath of Khan to Star Trek III.
Weirdly, they all have
or we had Battle Beyond the Stars, I think, on the show, and the Shadow of Stars,
very first episode.
Bruce Broughton, Silverado, young Sherlock Holmes. John Barry hasn't been represented. Black Hole, but the King Kong 76, terrible movie, great score.
Great score.
Legend of the Lone Ranger, terrible movie, great score.
Over and over.
The Black Hole, brilliant movie, brilliant score.
Not a brilliant score. It's 5 minutes of a brilliant score.
And Ennio isn't represented. Once Upon a Time in the West, Once Upon a Time in America. We have no Ennio Morricone. The Conversation, David Shire, Craig Safin, Last Starfighter. So there's a lot of other great composers that we have not touched upon. So I don't know if that's it. Steve, you've been awfully quiet. I'd love to see what Steve has to say.
Well, I'm still thinking of, movies that were improved by the score. I'm not necessarily looking for a movie that was terrible that was made interesting by a score. I'm looking for, a movie that was pretty good that was made great by the score.
Well, Bernard Herrmann and the Harryhausen movies, because that's why I didn't mention North by Northwest or Vertigo, Psycho. Those are all brilliant movies that didn't need Bernard Herrmann, although Bernard Herrmann made them even better than they already were. But, some of the Harryhausen movies really benefit, like Seventh Voyage of Sinbad. The Harryhausen Works Magic, or It's Alive, too, Bernard Herrmann score.
My backup movie that I almost chose was Wendy Carlos's Clockwork Orange, which 1971, that score, that early electronic score was so bold and groundbreaking. Mm. And I just watched the film again a couple weeks ago, and it's just that music is so powerful. But the movie is already a great film. So I don't know if it took an A movie and made it an A+ or a B+ movie and made it an A, but I still think of, John Williams accomplished this miracle a number of times. You could argue that Jaws was a mediocre movie until that score went in there, that incredible Jaws score.
Okay, can I make a counter argument? Jaws has been on the show. Jaws is a legendary score. But Jaws 2 is a terrible movie that is completely elevated by a John Williams brilliant score, and it's completely different. I remember on the soundtrack album, it's just all new music for Jaws 2. Just like Supergirl, which is a horrible movie, is elevated by
Jerry Goldsmith's score.
Marvelous score. So, there's definitely a lot of these movies.
Ashley mentioned Superman 78, a fun movie, but that score just makes it something special. And John Williams, Star Wars was like, nobody really knew what that was until that John Williams score came in. And we've obviously chosen it before, but I think that's a great example of a score that
took, it was the chosen one.
Or you could take Tim Burton's Batman movie in 89. Great Danny Elfman score.
Great Danny Elfman score, terrible movie.
Yeah,
but the score is great.
Well, look, the question is, have we had Star Wars on this show before?
Sure, we have.
Yeah,
of course.
Haven't we?
We have. I know it. Have we?
Ashley's picked Empire Strikes Back before.
No, then he changed it to Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Have we ever picked Star Wars?
I think I picked it.
For movies we're thankful for. He picked
right.
Because, you could argue, Empire Strikes Back. Well, Empire Strikes Back for Friday. you know, just because it looms so large.
Ashley's already picked Empire Strikes
Back. No, he replaced it with Breakfast at Tiffany's.
But I feel like then we picked it again for something else.
Oh, did we? Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. Well, then let's not pick it.
When you mentioned James Horner, I watched Braveheart last week for the first time in years. And the movie, it's a decent movie, but that John Horner, or that Horner score is really memorable. I mean, awful lot of bagpipes, awful lot of piping in that movie. But
But where I really respect him is if you look at Humanities for the Deep or Battle Beyond the Stars, which these are terrible movies, that his music elevated completely because the scores were so great. And right. Battle Beyond the Stars was back when that was fresh, before he recorded the same score eight times after that.
Right.
Well, yeah, Battle Beyond the Stars is only a copy of Star Trek the Motion Picture.
Is it?
Oh, absolutely. There's whole sections.
Magnificent Seven. Lift.
No.
Maybe. But, anyway. I mean, again, to me, like the... I mean, maybe this is all sort of about definitions, right? Because Steve is like, okay, so what was like a movie that was like made great by the music? To me, it's like, yes, but also like, in what way was the music groundbreaking? Like, in what way did it change, kind of, regardless of whether the movie was good or not, that we talk about the score in a way that's
I mean,
meaningful, right?
I would argue Michael Giacchino for The Incredibles.
That's true. Because it's very John Barry, but in this completely like different
way. Yeah.
Like, I like that score. I don't know if it would, I would program it when there's so many better choices. You know, I like his score. And it's one thing I'll give to 2009. I actually like his score to Star Trek 2009, which I'm not a huge fan of the movie otherwise, but I do love like his score quite a bit and the teaser.
Yeah, and he does some interesting things. Like, he takes the Alexander Courage and he transposes it, and like, he changes that theme, but it's still there. It's like, it's really some fascinating work.
But again, what about Ennio? We haven't touched on Ennio, and the he's so identified with an entire genre of movie music.
You could easily argue that those spaghetti westerns are just kind of these programmer, type, but they're good. But then his scores are so, for a few dollars more, or Good, the Bad, and the Ugly.
Well, I mean, we're going to go
with that. Personality.
Like yes, 100%. Like, I could, again, talk all day about the scores for those films.
Well, you've picked those for Western Week.
That's right.
So, I mean, I would say we'd have to go with, Once Upon a Time in the West, or because I think you picked for a few dollars more and The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
So that leaves us a fistful of dollars. Or Once Upon a Time in the West, which are both amazing scores.
You know who else we haven't talked about? And a movie that was not great but interesting, but had a great score, a truly great score was Starship Troopers.
Yeah, and Basil isn't represented. But have we picked Starship Troopers before on the show?
I don't think we have.
Because that is a great score.
Yeah.
And Basil, doesn't get the credit he deserves because he passed young. I mean, his Conan score is great. And his Conan Destroyer score is very different for a terrible movie. And it's also a wonderful score. Not as good as Conan the Barbarian, but it's quite good. But Starship Troopers is terrific.
You picked it, Mark, on Final Frontier Week.
Oh, okay.
Just a few months ago.
There goes that idea. What else did Basil do?
RoboCop.
Oh, yeah.
RoboCop was thankful for. Because I was thanking it for, now suddenly I can watch people's heads explode and be okay.
We did Conan,
We did Hunt for Red October.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yes.
We didn't do Lonesome Dove, now that we're picking TV shows.
Battlestar Galactica.
Well, you could take something
Battlestar Galactica.
Like Psycho. I guess that started as a TV movie, but Psycho, a nice little Alfred Hitchcock movie, but that Bernard Herrmann score is iconic.
Was that the first time he worked with Bernard Herrmann, haven't we?
We picked it during Hitchcock Week.
Yeah, you're right.
But we didn't pick Vertigo. There's
a reason.
Oh, fight words.
Now.
Okay. How about Henry Mancini we picked Life Force.
But Pink Panther?
We picked Charade in previous weeks.
Oddly enough, I just watched The Pink Panther last night.
I love Henry Mancini, dude. Absolutely. Yeah, guys, great story. If you could figure that out, that'd be amazing. Burt Bacharach for like for Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Like, I mean, the thing about here's the argument I'll make for that. Like that too, even though that's a great movie in its own right, like that score was very different. It wasn't what anybody would have expected it to be. And yes, like Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head is soundtrack, not score, but it also feels like it all feels of a piece. It all feels
it
like
all it's feels a, like it's the 70s.
Yeah, it feels like the 70s, which isn't so bad, except for the pants.
By the way, I'm not going to argue for this, but I got to give out props. You know, one of the great Jerry Goldsmith scores that people don't talk about is his score for Under Fire.
Absolutely. And
the fat is so great. And the fact that Quentin Tarantino used it in Django.
That's right.
It blew me away. I could not believe it. I mean, it was so cool. Like, I mean, most people don't even know the score exists.
And that's one of those scores that I will just put on and listen to.
Yep, me too.
Because it's great.
It's absolutely great.
If we're doing lists of things that are worth a listen, we mentioned Tangerine Dream, Risky Business, which has got like this amazing, unexpected Tangerine Dream score with like the great Love on a Real Train track.
But it's a hybrid with a bunch of songs too.
You know that's what right. else? There's another Goldsmith score that I will put on just to listen to. And I have only seen the movie once and maybe not all the way through.
What's that? It's
called Lionheart.
Oh, yeah.
But the score is absolutely phenomenal.
Well, I feel that way about the Russia House. I don't like the movie. I've only seen it once, but I listen to that score all the time.
Michelle Pfeiffer and Sean Connery. And I have no idea why I remember that, because I didn't like the movie either. Yet.
I still think like we don't have John Barry. Although, I mean, Ashley has an interesting idea, this whole idea of legend, both versions of legend. Although that would put Tangerine Dream in the final week twice. And I think that's too much for Tangerine Dream.
Yeah. I'm kind of...
If John Williams is in it once...
If we're going to go with John Barry, I would vote for Dances with Wolves. Because...
Da, 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 da.
That's, you know, that's one of those films that the score absolutely makes tons better.
Yeah, you could argue
even,
that.
Even with John Barry, which I'm not a huge fan of, he makes it better.
I'm honestly quite fond of Darren's pick of Metropolis.
I didn't even say Dances with Wolves, because I'm quite fond of the Dances with Wolves pick.
I like Dances with Wolves. I always have. And the score is terrific. I bought the score right after it came out.
Yeah.
It's been a part of my writing playlists over the years.
Yeah, I know. Like John Barry a lot more than you guys do. And I mean, I would make a passionate case for Body Heat if we hadn't already picked it. But I still think King Kong 76 too. This is exactly what we said. That, you know, Darren said, "Oh, I'm going to revisit a movie that I mentioned, but it's a different version." I thought, "Oh, you picked King Kong. Now it's going to be Kong 76."
I tricked you.
But it's not. You tricked me. You tricked. That's a playful word. but I would definitely go with Dance with Wolves or Wang Chung.
Yeah, I mean, like, look, I'm for it, dude. Like, I love that. And like, and you know, we'd at least like get like a really nice review from Rob Burnett if we did To Live and Die in L.A.
Well, and you know, look, we didn't pick Elmer Bernstein either, but we picked Magnificent Seven. We picked The Great Escape on the show. We picked Sweet Smell of Success. Now, obviously, he's done a lot of other great movies like Stripes and Airplane. We picked Airplane,
Ghostbusters.
I mean, so many Elmer Bernstein, and then there's so many other brilliant scores. They Man with the Golden Arm, but.
Mr. Bernstein.
Yeah, Stripes is a great score.
It is actually. Yep. You know what, kids? The fact that we can do that. Of course, now, in fairness, we can also break into song on a panel at Comic-Con. So it doesn't necessarily mean anything that we...
I love the idea of going with Stripes. When are we ever going to pick Stripes for military?
We're not going to pick it again. That's for sure.
Yeah, I know.
So why not?
unless we do Bill Murray week.
I think Stripes could be great.
Because all those comedies that Elmer Bernstein did in the 70s and 80s are all great. Like Airplane.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, Animal House, Stripes. I mean, he had Ghostbusters, the score for Ghostbusters. Forget the dumb Ray Parker song
The score is amazing.
So, like, to me, this is almost saying honoring all those by picking Stripes. You know, that whole
that's
run.
That's a good way to go.
Are you stuck in a dead end job?
We're going to be killed!
Oh, no.
Just keep your hands on the wheel. Slow down.
Not killed.
Personal problems got you down.
You can't go. All the plants are going to die.
Well, the U.S. Army can turn your life around.
Before I knew it, she was walking next to me, singing, do I did it, did it, dum, did it, do.
Join a whole new breed of professionals. Learn what it's like to feel like a man. Get your body into incredible shape.
Muscles, I love those muscles.
Doomin! Master important career skills.
What are you going to do with that?
This and this. Who's your friend? Who's your buddy? I am, aren't I?
And represent your country in foreign lands.
Gentlemen, we are in Germany!
So if you're a man who likes to take charge of your own life...
Boom, shakalaka, boom, shakalaka, boom, shakalaka, boom!
So am I to understand that you men completed your training on your own?
That's the fact, Jack!
That's the fact, Jack!
And this looks like your kind of challenge.
Lean killer! You're a lean, mean, fighting machine! I'll do it!
Join Bill Murray in Stripes. This could be the best experience of your life.
What the? A surprise party! I'll kill you! Whose idea was this?
I love it.
Yeah.
I think okay. It's crazy. It appeals to me. It appeals to the Wednesday in me.
That's really funny.
Thank you. It's my job. It's what I do.
What you do. Steve, you good with that?
Yeah, no, I love the score. I have the score. It's been a part of some plays, other playlists of mine. And it really does take a fun little movie and it gives a little extra juice.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. A little extra juice. That's what we need on Friday, a little extra juice. Because the juice is loose on Thursday and Friday.
Okay. Oh, my.
Raise a cup to Sergeant Hulka.
Okay. So on Monday, Steve Melching, tell us what we won.
Monday, it's Daft Punk score for Tron Legacy.
Tuesday, Darren Dochterman.
John Williams score for Jane Eyre from 1970.
Wednesday, Ashley Edward Miller.
Tangerine Dream's debut score for William Friedkin's 1977 Sorcerer.
On Thursday, it's Jerry Goldsmith's magnificent score for Capricorn One. And on Friday, it's Elmer Bernstein for... Stripes.
That's the fact, Jack.
Wow, you know, this could have been, forget a week, this could have been a month.
It could have been.
Yeah. You know,
it was almost a week. It's a fun week.
It's a fun week. It's a fun week. And if you don't, if you get bored on the weekend, watch Legend with the Jerry Goldsmith and the Tangerine Dream score.
That's right. Saturday and Sunday.
Killed right. 6 or 7 hours.
Anyway, well, this is great, guys, all as always. And we'll be back next Friday with another all-new theme week on the 4:30 movie. I want to remind you, you can actually watch us on the Electric Now channel. And you can download the free streaming app, Electric Now, at your favorite app store, or watch us on Roku or on Stir TV, Distro TV, and Sling TV, where the Electric Now channel is available, featuring us, the 4:30 movie, and some other fine podcasts, including the cartoon Barroom, featuring none other than Stephen Melching and Ashley Edward Miller. And if you like Star Trek, kids, check out The Inglourious Trekspirits with Darren Doctor and myself, Mark A. Altman, along with our new spinoff, Deep Space Podcast. No, our spinoff show, Trekspirits Briefing Room, and where we curate audio commentaries for significant episodes in Star Trek history. And of course, there's the great Best Movies Never Made with Steve Scarlatta and
Josh Miller.
Josh Miller, thank you very much.
Writer of Sonic the Hedgehog.
And if you're a fan of this podcast, please rate us 5 stars on Apple Podcasts. Subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts and check us out every week as our fourth season continues to march on and on and on. And we want to thank our great sound mixer, the great Bill Ritter, along with Mark Rivera, who's been making us sound so great these last couple of weeks in this new season, as well as our producer, Nellie Miscalli, and our associate producer, Zach Raggetts, and Peter Holmstrom, as well as Dylan Middlebrook, who has taken us to new heights on the Electric Now channel. So thank you for that. And until next week.
Thanks to our listeners who make us your soundtrack every week.
Wow, that's great. But we're not a score. We're a soundtrack.
We're
like Grease.
But wait, when we go
to Grease is the word.
Is that score or is that soundtrack?
That's the score.
No, that's score.
Okay, that's score. Score.
Now, if you were singing like you did on the recent cartoon Barroom, the Star Blazers theme, that would be different. That would not be score. Yeah. That would be soundtrack. That's why I hate when people say the greatest soundtracks of all time and they say Pulp Fiction. Now, Pulp Fiction has amazing songs and it's extremely well curated, but it's not a score. It's a soundtrack.
That's what we're for. That's what this podcast is about. Risky business, gentlemen.
Risky business. That's right. Risky business. Which, as we said during our teen movie, high school movie week, is still one of the great high school teen exploitation. It's not even teen exploitation. It's Porky's is teen exploitation. Oh, right. Risky business is great.
It's for little enterprises. Made. That's
right. Well, you know, Darren, Princeton can use a man like Darren.
Thank you.
Certainly now.
Certainly now. So anyway, it's always a pleasure being here with you on the 430 movie. And this is a good show because, you know, my wife, Naomi, she listens every week and she's a big fan of the show. And she said, you know, Bogart Week, not so great. I don't like when you just do one person. I like when it's a broader canvas where you don't have no idea what's coming up. She says, like when you do like Harrison Ford Week or Humphrey Bogart Week or, you know, Gene Hackman, I don't enjoy the show as much. So hopefully I'll be anxious to hear what Naomi has to say about this week, which I mean, we covered everything. We covered the waterfront. On the waterfront we were.
We forgot that one.
So yeah, Alex North, not a big fan of Alex North. I mean, Dragon Slayer is good, but I'm not a huge Alex North fan.
I'm not either.
Neither was Stanley Kubrick.
But I'm bummed.
That's for sure. Okay, well, I think it's time we got out of here. We don't want to overstay our welcome, or it'll be the 8:30 movie. So So until next week, on behalf of Stephen Melching, Darren Dockman, Ashley Edward Miller, Jessica Van Puttermaker, and myself, Pete Potwist, Eyewitness News starts now. We'll be right back.
This show was produced by Dean Devlin and Mark A. Altman and is an Electric Surge Network production.